Hello and welcome to the brand new Combine. I am once again your host, Ty Patton, and I'm joined by our producer, Nicholas Cohen.
Oh, okay.
I use your full name.
Yeah, I don't hate that.
No, I don't think I do either.
Very cool. Yeah, so this is the new and improved Combine.
Yes, it is.
We're fully a podcast now.
We are.
You will see our studio in just a second when we fade to our intro. I'm the new producer of it. We still have Ty. Nothing's changed in the hosting department. We have some new assistant producers. We have Edgar Rodriguez in the producer chair, and then also Elijah McClary. They've been a huge help. You will see our brand new logo. It's nothing shy of perfectness.
Agreed.
Perfection, actually. That's
big kudos to Elijah McClary.
Absolutely.
On the development.
And then Edgar Rodriguez has been a huge help as well. We're
indeed
really proud about our new song. We want to give a shout out to Only Jaleel Smith for cooking that up. It is amazing, to say the least. And then that is over our new intro video that we're also very proud about. And we have some massive things coming for Combine.
So I just
wanted to introduce that before the show gets started.
So for those of you who are joining for the first time, welcome in. This is the Combine. It's as good as it always is.
Isn't
but for those of you,
fantastic.
It's excellent. But for those of you who are returning, just know that just like a Little Caesar's pizza, us four boys are hot and ready for another great season of the Combine.
Yes, sir.
On Hitting the Field Network.
Yeah, leave it all on the court. Leave it all on the field. You gotta give it 100. That's from your head to your heel. This is the time that you wanted. It's time to jump in and run it. Let's get to jumping and running into securing the deal. This ain't pretend, it's for real. Turn up the temp just a little. With stakes so high,
he's gonna make the throw. It's a touchdown.
Good looking for him. Long throw, as always. Mike Evans, he scores again.
Mix it up for the combine. Push it to the limit. How I give it at the combine. Bet I blow your mind when it's lights, camera, showtime.
And welcome back. And with me is Nick Cohen.
Yes, sir.
Nicholas, Nick?
Whatever you want. Just Nick Cohen. You always say it like it's one name.
It's very kind.
Of course.
Thank
Ty
you,
Patton.
Nick Cohen.
It's the same thing.
Yeah, exactly.
John Warner.
Yeah.
Shout out John Warner.
Shout out John Warner. He's got a really cool Nissan Frontier,
well.
I think. Yeah.
There's a couple of us that it's just first and last name always.
Yeah. Hey, do you think John Warner goes mudding in that truck?
I don't know. I don't know if he likes.
Is he like prim and
like
perfect
that
country, or is he like, let me get my dirt boots spit in a glass kind of country?
Happy medium.
Okay. I like that.
I don't know about mudding though.
Yeah, probably. Yeah,
maybe
a bit
there
of a long shot. He
yeah
is a baseball fan, so I mean, it's always tough.
Right. Shout out John Warner.
Yeah, we love John Warner. So what we are talking about today is a little bit of fun. We only have like 26 short weeks or whatever it is until the NFL honors ceremony. And as Nick Cohen and I have done in the past, we are placing our bets. We are making some futures here,
yes,
for who are going to win these awards.
We're going to cash some money, even though
we
don't
are
going to
cash
some one
money
of us will.
I'm a big gambler.
Yeah.
I love gambling.
Why, who doesn't?
I'm shaking. I'm so excited,
okay,
for gambling.
Okay.
So for the awards, we've got a whole list of them starting up, and the first of which is going to be the most valuable player.
Yes.
The MVP.
Arguably the most valuable player in the league,
I would say.
Yeah.
That is what it's called.
Yeah.
So we've got a bit of a battle at MVP between the two of us, and I am going to go ahead. Well, Nick Cohen's is insane. Nick Cohen's
Ty Patton's
throws him in a mental asylum, dude. So I have what is his name? Like Clyde Junior Stroud?
Coleridge?
Coleridge?
Bernard?
That's insane.
So
CJ Stroud.
Is CB.
Oh, that's
CB
kind of a fire
Stroud
name. We're coining that. Patented combine. Nobody trademarked.
CB Stroud.
No, CBay.
Oh, I just misspoke.
Or Seabass, maybe?
Seabass Stroud?
One of the two. Seabass Stroud's kind of fire.
He could,
well, his
like
name is
fishing
like Coleridge Brown or whatever you said,
yeah,
it was. Like
Bernard.
Anyways, CJ Stroud. This guy is a monster. Last year, he was phenomenal. One of the best rookie seasons I've seen in quite some time.
Yeah.
Over a 5-to-1 touchdown ratio, which is the most important statistic that I want to highlight out of that, right? No rookie quarterback has a ratio like that. It's just unheard of for the most part. And coming into this year, you get him more weapons. Stephon Diggs is in there now, right? I know he's not a big name, but Ben Sko from the Rams is in there,
bro,
now. I love Ben
Sko. There's
Sko
like 20 bigger names on that team.
I don't want to hear it. Defensively, they bring in Danielle Hunter. I know there are more offensive names, but we got to keep the ball rolling.
We do.
C.J. Stroud, essentially, they really beefed up his entire offense, got him a better defense to start working with, and he's going to be getting a lot more chances to throw a ball downfield, right? I think he's got definitely the pocket poise that an MVP should have, and I think his opportunity to score, to make big plays, to make that case for MVP is only going to go uphill this year. And yeah. So, I mean, last year, I think he was in the conversation, so I would not be surprised to see him in the running or even win it this year.
He definitely was in the conversation because, as you saw in the graphic, he had seven turnovers. But two or three of those were fumbles, which still aren't a good thing. But, like, the fact that he had four or five interceptions in his rookie season is kind of crazy.
Yeah.
I don't necessarily hate the pick. I just don't know. Like, I think him getting MVP in his second year, like, that just screams a little bit Patrick Mahomes, you know? And I don't know about that. I don't know if he is the next Patrick.
Well, I mean, this next guy, Nick Cohen's pick over here.
Oh,
everyone over there has just got their hands on his rear end, the tush push.
Doesn't matter.
Okay, I don't so want to hear
it. I'm picking Jalen Hurts, okay?
Hurts to hear you say that, pal.
Get over it. My thought process is that it has to be a dual-threat quarterback. And we agreed on this, didn't we? Yes,
we did. I would argue that C.J. Stroud is somewhat of a dual-threat quarterback.
I would argue against that.
That's crazy.
200 yards. Most of that was, like 3-yard scrambles. But whatever. We can get past that.
Most of Jalen Hurts is their 1-yard tush pushes, bro.
Whatever. So Jalen Hurts, he had, I believe it was 15 rushing touchdowns last year. Yes.
Something crazy like that.
He had 23 passing touchdowns.
Fantasy monster.
Right. So passing touchdowns, that number needs to go up. It just needs to. I mean, you added Jahan Dotson, who is not – he's not even like a top 50 receiver. But he is a great wide receiver 3.
Agreed.
And so now your wide receiver room is stacked. If that – and you add a new offensive coordinator, Kellen Moore.
Mm-hmm.
If your offensive touchdown – or passing touchdowns, that is, does not go up.
Yeah.
We then have a problem. And then we just start considering some things. But he's a dual threat quarterback. Jason Kelsey's gone, so the tush push, it'll still be there, but maybe less effective. We'll have to see that week one.
Yeah, and on that same token, he's now suffering a bit because Saquon Barkley's in that backfield.
Yes, but I argue more it's Saquon Barkley suffering, that Jalen Hurts is there.
Interesting.
Yes. So my pick is Jalen Hurts. I really wanted to say Dak, and I'm not an NFC East guy. As you can see, I'm wearing a Dolphins jersey.
Isn't his name Dakota?
It is. Dakota Prescott. That works.
Yeah.
But he's not very dual threat. And people have been saying him for MVP for years. It's been him and Josh Allen, and it just has not happened. So
he is the king of the regular season, though.
Yeah, as
always
just
is.
Cowboys are.
Yeah.
49ers are, too. They don't get it done.
But moving forward, this is one I don't think we need to stick too long on. We both have the same thing. And our offensive player of the year this year, we both agreed on.
Sweet
it's going
king.
To be your sweet prince,
yeah,
Tyreek Hill.
King, not even prince.
Oh, really?
Yeah. King Reek.
Who's sweet prince? Is it Tua?
It might be. Might be Waddle.
Devon Achane?
No, I think it's Waddle, actually.
Waddle?
Yeah. Love me some Jalen Waddle.
Oh, maybe Tua's your sweet queen.
Okay. I don't mind that. Why not?
Oh, my goodness. So, as Nick Cohen obviously wanted Tyreek Hill to be Opoi this year. It's written on, what he's wearing, pretty much. He's a big Dolphins guy.
Isn't it?
And when he reached out to me and asked me, who's your Opoi? I said, I don't know. There's so many names on the board. And going through it, it was just like, Breece Hall, but you got Aaron Rodgers there. Bijan, but you got Kirk there. CMC, but nobody's repeated since 1980 at Opoi. And then receivers, it's pretty much the same thing. Just unequal opportunities because you have other guys in the same system, in the offense, right? It's just tough for other guys to win it. And it seems like Tyreek is the most viable option, even with Jalen Waddle for the past 2 years, 2 years consistently, 1,700 yards or more.
And the good thing about him is if he does not get it, I don't think it's then okay, if you were to go out on a limb and say it's Bijan, and he doesn't get it, maybe he just has a little bit of a lackluster second year.
Mm.
People might look at you and be like, were you crazy? You know, because he's a second year guy. Tyreek, though, he's a consistent offensive player of the year candidate. So even if we're wrong, which I don't think we will be, then people won't look at us funny.
Yeah.
It's Tyreek Hill.
Understand.
Kind of enough said.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. Enough said. Moving in, Depoy. Is one that I was very happy with your pick, but it wasn't the one I was thinking of. I am, because you already know I love Dan Campbell.
Yes.
I feel like that guy's missing
Dan
a couple
Campbell
front teeth.
Dan Campbell is my defensive player of the year pick.
I feel like that guy participated in some illegal activities in his youth. Probably. Like, I really like that about him. Like, he feels like the tough.
You relate,
you know,
a little bit?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I love Dan Campbell for that. You got Aiden Hutchinson
with
the Detroit Lions winning Depoy, which, like, I do not hate at all.
I was super hesitant because I'm not going to say the name yet, but the guy you chose, I really wanted to pick him because it is a contract year.
Mm-hmm.
That's all we'll say for this 30 seconds. But it's also a contract year for some of his teammates, and I just don't think that everyone can perform. I think it's just, like, even though situations like this have happened before, I think it's a little more likely that one person doesn't, and it makes the owner's decision a little bit easier.
Yeah.
So, and then I thought about, okay, TJ Watt is so due. He is.
That's the thing with TJ Watt, though. He's always due, and they never
give
like
it to him. He's like Josh Allen. I'm not going to choose Josh Allen for MVP.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Like, the guy that you almost feel deserves it the most never gets
right.
it.
Right. Yeah.
And it's just, it's a
tough,
tough thing.
I mean, Puka probably deserved Offensive Rookie of the Year more last year, but it's going to go to a quarterback. So, some things are just written in stone. It's a rule. And so, I want it to be slightly different. I think this guy could have a massive breakout season. Aiden Hutchinson,
yeah, I agree.
You know, 11 and a half sacks last year. It's not, it wasn't at the top of the league, but
that, no, but I really think you have to look at, like, the separate numbers that not many people will dive into, right? The forced fumbles, 3 on the season, which is relatively huge. I know 3 forced fumbles doesn't sound like a ton, but in football terms, that's a lot. On that same token, 7 pass deflections.
Yep.
Like, Micah Parsons had nowhere near those numbers.
No, and they
which
added.
I actually should say that my guy is Micah Parsons, now that I've mentioned him.
Okay, yes. And, I mean, the Lions added Marcus Davenport, but the big name addition on the defensive line is DJ Reader.
Yep.
So some of these guys, they are going to take some of the pressure off of Aiden Hutchinson. And
yes.
Or maybe more add pressure to the opposing offensive line.
Yes.
And so I think Aiden Hutchinson will have a little bit more
success. Despite being
an
edge rusher, they still want to double team him on a lot of offensive lines. Because Aiden Hutchinson, he's very powerful in his finesse, you know. But I don't think we'll stick on it too long because we'll be here all day.
Yeah.
We're going to dive into our O'Roy, our Offensive Rookie of the Year. O'Roy, how do you do me like this? Jaden Daniels, absolute menace with the Washington Commanders. Coming out of LSU.
Hopefully menace.
Hopefully menace. Not Antonio Brown type menace, but more like CJ Stroud type menace. You get the gist.
Yeah.
I really like Jaden Daniels. He's one of the only dual threat quarterbacks that I've seen in the previous years outside of Anthony Richardson that I think has a legitimate future in the NFL.
Yeah.
Like, he's just extremely talented. With this offense, right, you pair him with a offensive coordinator like Cliff Kingsbury, and then a defensive-minded head coach in Dan Quinn that I think can give him, like we were talking about earlier, more opportunity to have the ball, to put plays downfield to make something happen. I think Jaden Daniels has that oomph in him, you know?
I don't hate the pick whatsoever. I do worry about his weapons.
Understandable.
Trading away Jahan Dotson, as we mentioned. He does still have Terry McLaurin, who is a very confusing player in the NFL. But
in that same room, though, you got to remember, although they're not huge names, Luke McCaffrey and Dynamy Brown are still there.
I like Luke McCaffrey.
And I love Dynamy Brown. And then at tight end, we still have Zach Ertz and, I believe, Ben Sinnott.
Yeah, who's actually projected to start. We were talking about that
the
other day.
Out of Kansas State.
I don't hate it. I had him as, I want to say, my tight end two coming out of the draft. I'd
really?
Have to look back. He was 2 or 3 for me. I remember watching him play against UCF last year.
Yeah.
Destroyed us. So, I mean, then I watched some of his tape. But, I mean, even if the weapons aren't there, he had 1,134 rushing yards in his senior year. Well, his, like, super, super senior year last year. And that's just – it's so ridiculous for a quarterback because then he still had 3,800 yards. He was at the top of college football in passing yards and only 4 interceptions. He's an accurate guy, and that gets overlooked because of his dual threat ability.
Yeah.
So I don't hate the pick at all.
No.
I did choose Caleb Williams. Just
understandable.
You know, number one pick has so much better weapons and a better system, so it's kind of the cop-out pick.
Yeah.
But Jaden Daniels arguably has a more exciting – higher ceiling.
Yes. D-Roy.
Yes.
Though.
I'm excited about this one.
I'm very excited about this one. And I'm going to go over mine first just because we just talked about this same defensive room. Terrion Arnold out of Detroit.
CB1.
CB1. Well, is he CB1 or is he CB2
out of the
behind?
Draft, I meant.
I was talking about over Carlton Davis, but.
Oh, come on.
He's a buck.
Come on.
He's a buck. He's a buck in my heart.
Okay.
All right.
That's fine.
Come on, man.
I can't argue with that.
So, the same reasons we're just talking about. Marcus Davenport, right? Aiden Hutchinson, a very, very talented defensive line and a still intact linebacker room. That I think puts more pressure on a quarterback than many teams have in at least 5 years.
Yeah.
Like, there's a few that are in that conversation, you know, but the Lions are special right now, especially on defense. And they added Terrion Arnold. They added Ennis Raquestraw, correct me if I'm wrong,
yes.
I believe. Yes. Carlton
Underrated.
Davis.
Yeah.
So, after last year with a cornerback one of Cameron Sutton, who stinks, yeah. That guy is terrible. They get him out of the building, right? You get some new corners, you get some new DB depth, and then you give them. The defensive front,
think
the front seven that they have.
Oh, think of God. Where they'd be if Jeff Okuda wasn't a bust.
Oh,
think
dude.
Of that defense.
Think of how happy
seconds.
They would be if they put a Starbucks in the lobby so they could always have pumpkin spice lattes. I got to mention it. The pumpkin spice lattes dropped on August 24th, and I will drink one every day until I die. They're the most delicious drink I've ever had.
Starbucks, please sponsor us. We can
Oh, Starbucks, if you sponsor us, I will work the front. I will be your security guard. I don't care what it takes.
If
you give me one free pumpkin spice every day,
you will have a caffeine addiction.
I already do.
Okay.
Like Okay. Moving on. You're
yes.
D-Roy.
Okay, so I want to give a quick shout out to Pork Chop Robinson.
Oh, yeah.
Of the Miami Dolphins.
Yes.
And that's not even, I promise you, that's not even me being biased. That is because Jalen Phillips and Bradley Chubb are injured.
Yeah.
They are injured. They are likely to both miss the start of the season. We signed Shaquille Barrett from the Bucks.
And then he retired.
And then he retired before he even started playing for the Dolphins. What?
Yeah.
So.
Rough setting. But I do really like Pork Chop Robinson.
Yeah. But I don't think he'll get it. I really hope he does, and I think he has the potential because, again, he is going to be a starting edge week one, and if he performs, what's to say that Bradley Chubb doesn't now become a backup? Just saying. But I did not choose him. I chose Dallas Turner of the Vikings, and is it because he was the highest-rated defensive player coming out of the draft? Maybe. Maybe not, though, because he's playing on a Vikings defense that really needs him, and he made some nice preseason plays. So I just think it's more likely. I do think it'll be an edge defender rather than a corner just because the NFL seems to value.
Yeah.
Like, unless they go crazy and,
I mean,
a rookie corner gets, like, six picks or more, I think it's more likely that it goes to an edge defender that gets 10 sacks.
We've seen this time and time again, right, from the NFL. Like, I mean, last year, even the NFL did a little song and dance and skipped out on Devon Witherspoon, who had a rookie season.
It.
He so deserved it. They gave it to Jalen Carter, who still deserved. He still had a great season, but I don't think it was nearly as successful of a rookie campaign than Devon Witherspoon. Yeah.
Just he's almost not even a corner.
Oh,
his hit-sticking ability.
Yeah.
I love Devon Witherspoon.
Yeah. So, moving forward, we're going to go to Coach of the Year.
Okay.
Coach of the Year.
We don't have to spend too much time on this either.
No.
They're both two lovable coaches.
Yeah. And I want to say you and me both had these same coaches for last year's Coach of the Year when Combine was a TV show and not this cool podcast. So
yeah.
I'll start off with mine. I'll make it real short, real sweet. I've already mentioned him. Motor City Dan Campbell of the Detroit Lions. This guy that eats glass for breakfast and, you know, like nails in his cereal. This guy is tough, right? Like, I felt like he played football back in the day, real hard-nosed guy, long hair, real Alex Anzalone type. Now he's with the Detroit Lions as the head coach, and players seem to rally around him.
He's coached Alex Anzalone.
He has. He seems like the coach that players want to rally behind, and I really like that for him. I think he's a real player's coach, and I think that's why he ends up winning. That's why the guys like him so much. But
I don't hate it, and I
don't hate yours either.
I think yours has a great chance of happening because we'll do an episode, but we may or may not have him going pretty far in the postseason. But we may or may not also have the Texans going pretty far in the postseason, and
Indeed.
That's why I chose Ryans. Oh my God,
D'Amico Ryans.
Talk.
Yes.
I think the Texans are going to kill it this year, and he is the head coach of them. So. Mm-hmm. Why not give it to him?
Yeah, last year, just to briefly mention it, first-year head coach, rookie starting quarterback, rookie wide receiver 2 in Tank Dell, right? everything against him, and they still managed to put up one of the best seasons the Texans have had since Deshaun, you know, got some, was in that offense. Moving forward, though, we got assistant coach of the year, and this is one that I'm going to preface really quickly because I made a horrible mistake. I was talking about – well, I didn't make a horrible mistake. I made the pick, but I forgot that Dan Quinn became the Washington head coach. So I really wanted Dan Quinn as Cowboys DC to be the head, assistant coach of the year.
You could have chose Mike Zimmer.
I could have, but I don't like Mike Zimmer because that guy stinks. The only good thing Mike Zimmer did was Minneapolis Miracle.
He looks like Rudolph
the Red-Nosed
Reindeer. Yes. All the time.
Real rosy cheeks like a younger Santa Claus, except, you know, a little on the weirder side.
And not really young either.
No. I mean, Santa Claus is like 200 years old or something. Anyways.
So maybe.
So I instead realized that Dan Quinn had gone to Washington. Really liked that, actually. And I started thinking about, oh, I'm so high on Jaden Daniels this year. You know what? Give me Cliff Kingsbury as a Washington offensive coordinator in this situation. I don't hate it. I think there are better options on the table, which I should have thought about. But in a moment of passion and fire, you know, I threw him in the mix.
And I think it goes hand in hand with your pick for Offensive Rookie of the Year.
Yeah.
I think he will do a lot of good with Jaden Daniels. And so for my pick, I chose Bobby Slowick.
Understandable.
Who he was in the running last year.
Yeah.
Jim Schwartz of Cleveland. He is a two-time winner, I believe. And totally deservingly, because the Browns' defense is just amazing. But I think this is Bobby Slowick's year. I think it goes hand-in-hand with D'Amico Ryans for Coach of the Year, because that's what happened last year.
Yep.
So Bobby Slowick's winning this, I hate to tell you. Both amazing, great-minded offensive coordinators.
Yes, but and with that team around Bobby Slowick, it's hard to imagine a world in which he doesn't win it this year.
Ben Johnson in Detroit.
Yes. Completely agree.
Also was in the running last year.
Completely agree. And now we'll flow into our last award, which we don't even need to spend time on. Comeback player of the year.
I'm not happy about it.
I'm not either, low-key. Like, if Aaron Rodgers walked out on the field and did, like, a somersault, like, they'd give him the award. Yeah. Like he's the NFL's dancing monkey at this point.
Give it to him on a silver plate.
Yeah. Like, they're just parading this guy around. And hey, will he come out running with the United States flag again? Will he come out American flag again?
I don't know. I think that'd be kind of funny.
That would be hilarious, actually. Like, oh, there it is right there, actually. Yeah.
Or maybe, like,
that.
A medical flag, too.
A medical flag.
Yeah, just a white flag.
NFL flag. They just slapped
throwing
it
in the white. Yeah.
Those are the craziest stats I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah, so
what are we doing?
He had a whopping year last year. He went 0-for-1 on passing for 0 yards, got sacked, and had a 2.5 quarterback rating with a max, by the way. Quarterback ratings, you can go up to 128.3. So,
and I'm pretty sure you get a 30 quarterback rating if you just throw the ball at the ground a bunch of times.
So he did not perform well.
No, not at all.
But there are some other candidates like Nick Chubb. We all love Nick Chubb.
I just found out this morning. This morning they postponed Nick Chubb for a Week 4 release on his injury.
Okay.
Went to the doctors, and the doctor said, you got to hold out some more, pal. And they gave him some more morphine or whatever it was and just sent him on his way.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. I really hope Nick Chubb can win it, but we know the NFL loves Aaron Rodgers. So
the NFL does love
Aaron
Rodgers.
We didn't overthink it. And that Nick Chubb return will be against the Raiders, and they're really difficult defensive line. So good luck to Nick Chubb if you're watching. I know you're not.
Yeah, and then the Jets and the Ayahuasca Angel, you know, they're playing are they playing the Niners? I don't know. But anyways, that is all the time we have for our first segment, but don't go anywhere because instead of talking awards, we are now going to be talking who our rookie quarterbacks of the future are.
Yes.
Be right back after this. Welcome back. But this time we are not joined by the illustrious Nick Cohen. No, sir. We are joined by Jack Hansel and Matthew Brackard, two fans of teams that have rookie quarterbacks. One of them just got the starting job. The other one just started his stay at a hospital. So we are going to dive into all these quarterbacks and their futures, what we think is going to happen with each of them, and we are going to go in the order that they were drafted. Now, before we go into that, we are in a new studio.
Mm-hmm.
You are both returning guests on the Combine, so how are we? What do we think of studio?
I'm doing good. I love it. I love the place.
Oh, yeah?
A lot of possibilities.
I'm excited to be back. The Prophet took, like, a good year off. I'm back though, as better than ever, to be honest with you.
I'm happy to come back after the heinous April Fool's prank you pulled on me.
That
last time
was,
I was here.
Excellent. I don't want to hear heinous in front of that. Heinous. That was the best. I still watch that like once every few months. Like I love watching that over. But anyways, good to hear you're both doing good. You know, welcome to the pod. And we're going to dive into these rookie quarterbacks. And the first one we got is obviously Caleb Williams at the 1-1 to the Chicago Bears. And it was no surprise. I don't really think we need to go into his college stats all too much, but they're here if you want to see them. I think instead we're going to focus on how far can this guy go? What will his records be? Can he take Chicago to the playoffs, or is he just a glorified Justin Fields?
You know, it's interesting, right? Because Caleb, really, I don't think he had a really great senior year last year, but
not as
he's
good as
had
a junior.
Yeah, he had a pretty good collegiate career, and I mean, he's got a pretty good supporting, you know, cast around him in Chicago, right?
Yeah.
DJ Moore,
yep.
Keenan Allen, yeah.
Romo Dunze, Cole Kmet, Gerald Everett, DeAndre.
Yeah, he has tools. He has
DeAndre
weapons.
Swift. It's just endless amounts. Just this depth chart is loaded.
The thing is, I mean, even if he has a mediocre season, he has potential to have one of the best seasons in Chicago Bears like quarterback history.
Yeah, but that's not very
the bar is low.
Yeah. That's not a very tall task.
Yeah.
Any thoughts, Jack Hansel?
Yeah, listen. With Caleb Williams and the Bears, like, I live by a model that it's taken me pretty far. It worked every year until last year with the Lions, where, like, and for this case, the Bears have not had a good quarterback.
Yeah.
Until Caleb Williams goes out there and proves he's a good quarterback, I don't think he's going to be a good quarterback with this organization. I don't.
Yeah, that's and also fair. But let me pitch the concept here, and I just want genuine honesty with this one from either of you. With DJ Moore, Keenan Allen, right, Cole Kmet, right, Romo Dunze, all these guys are first round picks or the most talented receivers, some of them in the league right now. Can a quarterback fail with a roster like this? Like, if you're a halfway decent quarterback, like, can you fail with this supporting cast around you?
I think you got to try. I think you have to try to fail, truthfully.
Yeah.
It'll be tough. It'll be a tough sabotage from coaching. And I don't know about y'all. I do not like Matt Eberflus.
No. I've never
been
that's
what
Matt
I'm
Eberflus
worried about,
guy.
Yeah, I'm not a huge fan of Shane Waldron, the Seahawks old coordinator last year. Not a huge fan either. I don't know if maybe you guys have more study on that than me. No. But, yeah, I don't know. The roster's good. Caleb's supremely talented. Like, as a Vikings fan, I am scared because Caleb probably is going to be very good, and he's going to rule that division for a long time.
Yeah.
But, like, until he actually does it, I have no reason to believe a Bears quarterback will be, like, anything more than a Bears quarterback.
And I think the problem that they did this year was they put all their eggs into the basket of this year. Like, so many of their players they brought in outside of, like, DeAndre Swift for this year are on one-year contracts, right? And I don't know if they're going to have the money to pay everybody. I mean, Keenan Allen already deserves a bag. Like, he hadn't even played a snap yet.
Yeah. Well, I would say that's a good thing. I would rather them put their eggs into a basket this season and get Caleb rolling off the start than just, like, surround him with, you know, the Darnell Mooney project and DJ Moore all year long. Like,
That's true.
With Caleb Williams, you're going to have four more years, including that fifth-year option of him being cheap.
Yes.
So, like, they can have a one-year project, and they can sign out more – you know, high market veterans next offseason, rebuild, shape the team how they need to for
the Bears. You might as well build his confidence now.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
But outside of him, he right now, I think, was everybody's pick for Opoy. He was everybody. Some people said he was going to win MVP in his rookie year. It was ridiculous. But anyways, that's the guy that everybody's talking about. Like, his name is in everybody's mouth. But right behind him, one pick behind him, so literally, is Jaden Daniels out of LSU, who's with Washington now. He's got Cliff Kingsbury as his OC. Dan Quinn, defensive-minded guy, as his head coach, and he had a phenomenal 2023 season with LSU. You know, there is still that potential that Brandon Ayuk gets brought in the building. I don't know if it's a good chance at all, but there is the chance. They were teammates at ASU for a year, but now with Washington, outside of the Ayuk potential, right, Terry McLaurin, I want to say Jahan Dotson, he's with Philly. Dynamy Brown, Luke McCaffrey, Zach Ertz, Ben Sinnott, guys like this, right? Austin Eckler, can't forget him.
Yeah.
Oh,
I did forget that.
This guy's also set up for success, right? Very much so.
Yeah.
Is he?
I think so. Scary Terry?
No.
Oh, that is true, actually.
No.
How did I forget about Scary Terry?
You forgot about Scary Terry?
I forgot. I feel like a lot of people forget about Scary
Terry. Scary Terry is still scary. Make Terry scary again, dude. Like, get that guy
that
back
is
in business.
True.
He has been flopping a little bit, but I still think he has the talent to be successful as a wide receiver one in this league. Regardless,
name two other wide receivers on the Commanders right now outside Terry McLaurin.
Luke McCaffrey, Dynami Brown. Wow. I want to say Olamide Zaccheaus got signed over there.
Superstars. Who? Who was the last person?
Olamide Zaccheaus?
I don't even know who that is.
What? Yeah, former Atlanta Falcon legend Olamide Zaccheaus?
Oh, my God. This guy.
Oh, wow. Look, this is heinous work.
This is a classic.
I think someone needs to step up as the number
This is the
two.
Same caliber True. Of post. I remember last year you on Instagram for your Shadir account, you had – who the –
Oh, I just said it's shit over.
Yeah, that one.
That's
that
what
one.
I'm going to say to shit over if I ever meet him. It's shit over,
but
pal.
But you had the Cardinals signing Paris Campbell as a huge, huge signing. Like, great wide receiver four. It's Paris Campbell. He still sucks.
Okay, understandable. But look.
So, like, this guy, I don't know who he is. I'm sure he's a great guy. But, like, do I trust him to be on the NFL field during the regular season?
But
absolutely
look, like,
not.
Like, if I go hang out with a group of friends, right, there's always that one weird kid there that shows up. And you still like the guy, but, like, he's a little bit different. Paris Campbell's that weird guy, right? Paris Campbell walks in the building. There's a 50% chance this might be the coolest guy you ever seen. He just, like, sniffs toes in the offseason. You know, you just don't know. Right. You never really know with a guy like that. And so there's always – he's a wild card. But speaking about Jaden Daniels, this is the interesting guy of the hour here. Can he be successful? I think he's going to win Oroy. I think he's going to be fantastic. Yeah. But can he be successful? And do they need to add pieces like Caleb did to this offense for him to be successful?
I think maybe one. You know, I think a trusted name at wide receiver would help alongside Scary Terry. You know, Daniels is a great runner, obviously. You know, won the Heisman last season. You know, it's a very different look than what Sam Howell from, you know, last year.
Yeah.
I think their main thing is, you know, they got to be careful not running him into the ground. You know, he's young.
Because, I mean, on the same token, Anthony Richardson played very similarly. Mm-hmm. And we saw where that got him. But I want to ask the prophet this. Look into your magical medicine ball, whatever you got over there. And gotcha. Tell me, is Jaden Daniels... Can he win the Super Bowl with this team?
I mean,
at some point.
With the 2024 Commanders, Jaden Daniels will never win a Super Bowl. With the Commanders, I don't know what they're going to build in the future. I have no idea. What I'll tell you about Commanders this year is I don't love them this year simply because we talked about how Caleb Williams had worse stats last year. It's no coincidence Cliff Kingsbury was his offensive coordinator. Jaden Daniels now has Cliff Kingsbury. Not a huge fan. The weapons aren't there. I don't see it this year for Jaden Daniels.
Well, I don't see it this year either, but...
You just had him Oroy.
Oh, Oroy, definitely, but definitely
Super
Bowl.
Okay, well, you do see it this year.
No, not Super Bowl. Maybe.
Well, I know, but
maybe,
good.
Like,
I don't see him being...
Oh, you guys I see, I see, I see.
It's going to be Bo Nix winning Oroy, but we will get
that's
to that.
That's ridiculous. We will get there. All right, yeah. We have Drake May up on the board from the New England Patriots, which... The Patriots shafted this guy pretty bad. They also brought in Joe Milton to always have that, you know... hand on his shoulder, telling him, you know, you're not good enough, pal. We got somebody else to replace you the minute you screw up. And it's kind of been a tale of two quarterbacks in the preseason right now. Joe Milton had a phenomenal week one.
Yeah.
Drake May had a pretty good week two and three. Obviously, they're going to start May because they drafted him at 1-3, right? You're not going to start the guy you drafted in the fifth round. But at the same time, I do think Drake May isn't necessarily... a top six quarterback in this draft or a top five quarterback in this draft. I don't love the guy. I know Jack Hansel has some opposite thoughts, so I want to ask you why. And then I want to say, you know, ask you, is there any chance we see Joe Milton get a couple starts this season?
No, absolutely. Like, it would have to take multiple injuries.
Yeah.
I don't think so. So, no, like, Drake May, everyone on the draft night, before draft, every minute has always been he's going to be more of a project.
Yes,
but, like,
agreed.
Again, as I was saying before, like when you're in the AFC and you have Patrick Mahomes facing you, you got to get a quarterback that's going to be a playmaker. That's the whole Anthony Richardson idea. Richardson, he's not a good enough passer to make a run in the playoffs at all. But like with the physical tools he has, the ceiling is there. Like, and that was the problem with, and I like what they did because it was the exact opposite of Mac Jones. What the Patriots did with Mac Jones, they had a really safe quarterback. They, you know, they were trying to bridge with Tom Brady. So they try to get the most pro-ready guy, but, like, you just have such a limited ceiling with Mac Jones. Drake May, is he there yet? No. Is he even currently the fifth best quarterback in this year's draft? No, because I think every other guy was more pro-ready for this season than Drake May in the first round. But I think when it comes to ceiling, like, that's a shot worth giving because if it doesn't work, guess what? You're still going to be top of the draft as your quarterback stinks. And when you know your quarterback stinks, you're going to be...
Yeah,
you do it again.
I'm just worried they're going to make the same mistake that they made with Mac Jones. And the best receiver they're going to decide to give him is DeMario Douglas.
Yeah, right? That is true.
That is where they screwed up with Mac Jones. And, I mean, sure, you got Hunter Henry, but that guy fell off. Yeah. Like he's still falling. That guy jumped off a cliff 4 years ago, and he hasn't hit the ground yet.
Well, Mac Jones... He had a good rookie year. I think the biggest problem with Mac Jones, and hopefully they'll make the same mistake with Jerick May, is hopefully this time they can avoid hiring a defensive coordinator and special teams coach to be their offensive coordinators for their team. Like, that's probably the biggest thing.
I think with May, I don't think he's in a position to succeed right away.
Yeah.
Honestly, I know he had the great, the pretty good game last night.
Yeah.
I think you might want to consider starting Brissett for a little bit.
Because
not a bad move.
You don't want to put May into a position where he won't succeed.
Yeah.
And then, Pats fans, they're relentless.
Agreed.
So May has a couple bad games starting out. Like, they're not going to, want to waste time. They're going to, call for, a new quarterback.
Yeah.
May needs work.
And I agree, and I could actually totally see them starting Brissett for a little bit, giving him time to learn. But also, the Patriots are a very day one offense. Like, I can't remember the last time they drafted a quarterback in the mindset to use him, and they let him sit behind somebody for a little bit. I think every other quarterback in this class kind of has that outside of the top two.
Everyone's idea of the Patriots, though, is just not correct because Bill Belichick is no longer there.
That's very true.
It's Gerard
Mayo. Yes.
But do we know what to expect? I mean, honestly.
Well, no, but
I don't. I really don't think he's fit to be a head coach at this point.
I don't either.
But it's too young. Well, before we move on, let me ask you a question. This is something I've been toying around for a little bit. What do you think would have been the better move? Drafting May where they drafted him and then using the fifth round pick on whatever, or Marvin Harrison Jr. at 3 and then Joe Milton and trying to run with that?
Get your quarterback.
You like May.
Get your quarterback. I understand the argument of building round pieces, pieces before you get your quarterback, but when you do that too much, you get to a point where you start to become too good, and then you end up, case in point, the Vikings. The Vikings are always going to be a 7-9-1 team, so they're always going to be stuck around the 12th, 13th pick in the draft. Like, they're not going to be able to get that top quarterback.
Yeah.
The Patriots had it right there. And I understand they have tons and tons of needs, but, get your quarterback.
I'll pitch the same thing with the 2019 Bucks. Very talented roster, couldn't do anything. Well, all of a sudden we bring in Brady and we win a Super Bowl. I agree with you there. I agree with you in that setting.
Yeah. I think if they didn't draft a quarterback in the first, if the Broncos didn't draft a quarterback in the first, it just would have been...
It'd be shit over?
Yeah. It'd be shit over. Exactly.
It's shit over.
But there was a team that should not really have drafted a quarterback.
Oh, yeah. We're going to be diving into them right now. And this was the Michael Penix. Yeah, go ahead. You can apply. This was the Michael Penix draft. This is the moment we found out. This is the most insane thing ever, dude.
Studio, 5 seconds before this, was freaking out.
Yeah.
And then we just start hearing you scream. And then I think someone's like, where is Ty going?
Oh, yeah. I took off running, dude. I would not going to sit down for that. This was... You know how gullible I am, I say. I am truly one of the most gullible people of all time. Like, you could have told me the sky was green and I would walk outside to double check.
Because it just sounds like a joke. It just sounds like a joke. You sign Kirk Cousins to a 4-year, whatever, million-dollar deal.
And then you draft Penix.
Yeah. And it's like, okay.
I'm going to take a quick second to appreciate my Mad Mel Kiper cosplay right there.
You are giving Mad Mel Kiper for
sure. Oh, yeah. I even grew out the back of the hair so I could put it down and then do the split part and look like an idiot.
I understand, Kirk Cousins is, he's getting a little up there in age. He's not really, he's not there in his career. So I understand, why not get a rookie quarterback and maybe sit him? You look for Joe Milton in that role, not Penix, who is coming off a national championship loss, 24 years old. What is he going to do?
Well,
sit for 2 years?
My thought process is you don't even have a guy on your draft board unless you are thinking about taking him, at least in some regard. So if you knew that you really liked Penix, because they signed Kirk after the Natty, right? If you knew that you liked Penix, why sign Kirk to a 4-year deal?
Exactly.
Why not sign him to a 2-year deal? Why not a 3-year deal? Because, at this point, you were letting him train behind Kirk Cousins for his entire rookie contract before you extend him. If
Kirk's
you play
deal,
that in that way.
Yeah, Kirk's deal isn't fully guaranteed, though.
No,
it's
not.
It's guaranteed for 4.
Which is
good. My issue with the Penix pick was not even drafting a quarterback in the first round, because I do get to thinking. Kirk's coming off Achilles, 36 years old, I understand. Like, and the age stuff is weird. The biggest problem with the Falcons to me with this is that they obviously want to be competitive.
Yes.
Respect it. I completely agree, respect it.
I think they can.
But, like, when you have Kirk and there's a chance your rookie quarterback could be better, why would they draft a lefty? Because if Penix comes in, they're going to have to switch the offense.
That's so fair.
They have to switch the offense. Yeah, so if they don't draft a lefty, like, I think the handoff is a lot more seamless and, the transition makes sense. But, like, in case Kirk does go down or in case Penix is really that good, they're still going to switch the offense completely around. It just it doesn't – that does not make sense to me.
My biggest problem with this move, though, is that normally, typically, in these kind of mega contract deals – you can't trade away your starter until right after year two, maybe even year three, depending on how much money you offered, before you can actually save money on that deal. So regardless, they are locked in to that much money. Now, before we move on, I'm gonna ask you one quick question. They went and got Matt Judon in a trade with the Patriots.
Oh, yeah.
Every year for the last 5 years, I've wanted them to take an edge rusher in the first, and they've always passed for offensive skills. So, Matthew Becker, I want to ask you, do you think that they always had it in their mind they wanted to go out and trade for a guy? Or was it just, circumstance?
I think there's a lot of good, I feel like, trade targets this offseason. So I think it was always in their plans to target, a defense. I just thought that they were going to target, an offensive, playmaker, not a quarterback in the draft.
All right, well, now we have Jack Hansel's derelict queen, J.J. McCarthy, out of the Michigan Wolverines, heading to the Minnesota Vikings.
Moment of
silence for J.J. McCarthy real quick. Thank you. Wow. This guy had a actually very, very successful college career. When I went back and watched his tape, I was so surprised at how good he actually was. The accuracy and precision, good Lord, this guy hasn't eaten my pumpkin spice. That's what it is. He has so much poise in a pocket, so much accuracy, so much precision for a quarterback who's never played an NFL game in his life. And it feels like he's going to step right into an offense almost.
He was in the best position too.
Yes.
Honestly.
Behind a quarterback who maybe isn't the best. We were just talking about Sam Darnold. That guy kind of stunk for a while. But you put him in an offense with Jettas, I should say, now that they're both. Jordan Addison, Hawk, all those guys, right? You have the potential to let him learn behind a very highly taking quarterback in his own respective class, Sam Darnold. And give him a year, which I think that was the original plan. And then even as a backup, what would you say? Devil doesn't choose favorites, dude. And they just ripped his Achilles out or whatever he did. Was it his Achilles? Was that what it was?
Something like that.
Meniscus.
Yeah. Meniscus. Out for the year.
Meniscus.
So Jack Hansel, I know this is a guy that you were very fond of, especially being that he's a Viking. Is that biased? And how successful do you think he can be in the years to come?
Yeah, well, you mentioned the weapons, and the weapons are true, but I think another underrated thing is that Vikings arguably have the best tackle tandem in the league between Darisaw, who is an absolute dog, and Brian O'Neill is a very good right tackle.
Yes.
Very good right tackle. So they have great tackles too. Kevin O'Connell, great coach. I loved it. I do think Sam Darnold was going to play all year long, assuming he went to plan out. The Vikings started out 0-6, and obviously that's not going to play. Yeah. But I don't think they're planning on doing that, and I don't think they will do that either.
So, do you think there's any chance, given that McCarthy's out for the season?
Yeah.
They've already confirmed that.
Yeah.
Do you think there's any chance they try and extend Sam Darnold for a year to give him that time with McCarthy, or do you think they just pass the torch as soon as his contract's over?
I think they pass the torch. The GM, Kwesi, he's a very analytical guy. He used to be a stockbroker. He's just analytics. And he knows that, as you mentioned before on today, the quarterback contract time clock is ticking. So, once you get into year two, it's going fast. Yeah. They can't just do it again. I think they go out there. And again, at some point, you got to find out if you have the guy. Because if you don't, you can always redraft.
Yeah.
That's why I don't understand when people get so worked out over quarterbacks. I understand it might set you back 2 years. But, you're allowed to get another one. You are allowed to get another one.
It's not over.
That's what happened with Teddy Bridgewater. We signed Kirk Cousins. You're allowed to get another one. Right. So.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We are going to go ahead and dart off into our next one, which we have another big fan of, and he's actually wearing a Teddy Bridgewater jersey, believe it or not. Only this time it's with the most dookie franchise in the last year. I'm sorry. It's just Russell Wilson did it to you. It's not your fault.
No, I'm a victim.
Bo Nix gets taken at 12 to the Broncos. And so this guy is very successful. I'm going to give you the floor for a minute or so. I just want you to tell me why you think he's good, why he's going to succeed in a Sean Payton offense.
I will tell you why. Because he's a pocket passer. Because he has the weapons. He has the tools. Okay? Yeah, he doesn't have a great offensive line, but as long as he can stand up and deliver to these Cortland Suttons, he's getting his Oregon wide receiver and Troy Franklin. Marvin Mims is a speed threat, right? And I mean, he set the record last year for completion percentage. This is a guy who has experience. He has experience in the college, collegiate level, and he has shown that, he's a accurate passer. He's a deep ball. He has an arm.
Yeah, I agree. And I'll clear the air on that. That's the completion percentage in college football. That's not just in a division or anything. That's in college football.
Yes.
Phenomenal collegiate performance last year. And he's with the Broncos now. Luckily, they no longer have Russell Wilson, but they also have another stud that likes to wheel and deal moms, Zach Wilson. It's going to be a big competition for who can get the most Cougars this year between those two. So we'll see how that plays. We're going to go ahead and close out of here. Thanks for tuning in. This has been the new and improved Combine. I have been your host, Ty Patton. This has been Matthew Bracker, Jack Hansel, and the corpse of J.J. McCarthy. And we will be back next week to likely talk more football. See you soon.